1780 to 543 AD, basically a period of 243 years, which was the primary time in India when Hinduism and its iconography got fully developed.
Prior to that, there was development in iconography and Hindu gods, but it became under Samudragupta, it really took steam and actually gained a lot of importance, and the Brahminical version of Hinduism really became strong and more pronounced in sculptures and coinage and art. So what I am, this talk deals with is just to show you how it progressed in those 243 years, especially in the first 100 years of the start of the Gupta dynasty from Chandragupta 1 through to Samudragupta's reign into Chandragupta 2. So this book, Treasures of the Gupta Empire, was released in 2016, but it's about 30 years of research. It took me about 3.5 years to write the manuscript, and I gained a lot of pounds just sitting at the desk writing it. So this is today considered the Bible of Gupta coins, and I'm very happy to find that across the world, researchers and scholars are really utilizing the research data which has been provided there. So the study and the book was based on actually reviewing about 7,000 gold coins. It is a very detailed study, and it was at that time in 2016, I had a chance to look at almost every single gold Gupta coin. And the majority
of these were private collections and national museums or private museums that are not open to anybody to go and see. But because of, you know, me being a major collector, my connections, getting the help of friends, I was able to access a lot of these vaults. For example, the vault in Harkala Bhavan had not been opened since 1962, but through some friends, I was able to get the seal broken, get that the trays open for me to look at, and I was amazed at what was in there, and what was documented in books was totally different. So by taking that, now it's because back then in 1962 they didn't have enough information. Today we have more information and data, so I was able to then update that with this book. He shared something with me the other day. He said, this is the only history book a sitting Prime Minister of India has ever released. So I thought this is important to be our attitude. So the question is, who issued this coin? Was it Chandragupta 1 or Chandragupta 2? And the difference is Chandragupta 1 started the Gupta dynasty in 319 AD, then came his son Samudragupta, and then about 378 AD came Chandragupta 2. Now the coin doesn't say I am son of Chandragupta 1 or Chandragupta 2, it just says I am Maharaja Dhiraja Chandragupta 2. So how do we determine who issued this coin? So this can only be certain if we study the entire corpus of Gupta coin. Not 100 coins, not 1600 coins, because I see some research papers floating around where they'll take a group of 1000 coins and they'll be like, oh, you know what, based on this, blah, blah, blah. Well, look at the entire corpus of Gupta coins, including silver coins and copper coins and lead coins, to actually understand what conclusion you're reaching and is that conclusion correct. So, what's important to understand in reference to this specific point is there are actually three different designs for the couch type issued by King Chandragupta II. A king called Chandragupta. We don't know it's one or two. So, when you ask a very knowledgeable Gupta collector or a researcher, and you say how many couch type coins there are, let's say two, 99.9% of the people do not realize there is a third couch type, which is actually the key to this discussion. So, when we say the coin in the back has Sri Vikrama, and in the front of the coin it has Chandragupta or Chandra on it, the question naturally is who issued these coins? This is an archer type. Please write to a Chandragupta. Who is this issuing? archer like this, but in a bow in his hand, right hand holds an arrow. Who issued these coins? It says Chandra there. And then it says Sri Vikrama on the right. And then Varus is shown seated on a throne. You see, the goddess on this other coin is seated on a lotus. So is it fair to say that these are both issued in the same, you know, 5 year period, that the goddess 5 years back was issued, seated on a throne, in her right hand she holds some strange device, and on this one she is seated on a lotus and holding a lotus on her hand. Well, this transition took a long time. In ancient India, things just didn't happen over, you know, overnight. This took a period of about 70, 80 years before we reached this. So Sri Vikrama is a ruler on both of these coins. But you see, in the back, the goddess is totally different. You see, goddess in throne, goddess on lotus. Sri Vikrama. Now the question is, this title, Vikramaditya.
So we all know Vikramaditya, you know, King Vikramaditya. Well, who the heck was Vikramaditya? Well, Vikramaditya is a title that goes back to 57 BC. So many cases you use the title Vikramaditya. Every little Raja that decided to get himself importance said, I am so-and-so Vikramaditya. It was a very common title. Actually, Sri Vikrama as a Garuda was not exclusive to one Gupta king. It was actually used by eight different Gupta kings that we know of, and probably more will find out soon. So you see here, Chandragupta I, Samudragupta, Chandragupta II, Skandagupta, Kumaragupta I, Chandragupta III and IV, Buddhagupta. They all used Sri Vikrama on their coins because they considered themselves Vikramaditya. So if we just use the basis of Sri Vikrama, we cannot really say this was issued by a specific Chandragupta. Which one? We don't know. Very hard to say. This is the most important outside point. There are only five specimens known. Actually, six specimens. One is the fake, which is a copy in the British Museum. And then there are, actually, I shouldn't say fake, it's a copy, I don't know, it's a fake, which we should classify as fake. But more importantly, this is two pieces in Bharatsala Bhavan. One is in National Museum and two are in my collection. This point, as you can see, is a very crude.
Throne, as you can see, was seated on. Oh, So here, this is a Gupta period terracotta sculpture, which was in my light, and I looked at it, and I looked at the description, it says it's a scene from Mahabharata, where they're shooting the bowl, and they point it to the bowl on the top side, and there's a bowl there. And I looked at this, and it says, this is a Iconography region, both of them say it has to be Gupta period, but this description is totally wrong. So why is this important? The importance is that coins help us tie all this together, because coins were struck as a medium of trust. No king could issue a coin if the population did not trust it. If the population didn't trust it. So the coin had to have gold purity, which was acceptable, it had to be a certain weight that was acceptable. The front of it and the back of it had to be the royal emblems, which proved to the population that this coin actually can be accepted as currency in a certain region. So here, this is actually a scene from Mahabharata, in the battle between Janaka and Yudhishthira. And the reason we know is because that is a crescent standard, a Balachandra Dhwaj, which was a Shemite symbol. And this is the penance from the standard. Now, in that scene I showed you, you see, over here, they have restored it, and they have filled in this gap here. So the standard, the dhwaj, was missing. Somebody did it in here, but I can see the penance here. It's the dhwaj down here, so it was very clear that there was an error made in this creation. Right? Okay, so we know that's a penance. We know that's a Varaha dhwaj. That's the right symbol. That's a lotus stamp being held by a goddess, Lucy, Sri Lakshmi. And, a pendant from Dakshina. Now, the museum in, I think this is somewhere around the 4th century AD, this goddess is holding very important things. She's holding in both hands. One hand she's holding a lotus, but the other hand she's holding a lotus on top of which there is a bowl with fruit in it. Okay, so we have a crescent standard, which is a bowl. Now, this is a point of summary. Struck right around 340, 350 AD, because that's when he took away and he started his military campaign to basically expand the empire and basically take over most of the northern India. Right here is a crescent standard. Goddess is holding a lotus, that is, goddess on a makar, on a makar, which you can see quite elephant-headed fish representation. And of course, lotus association with Ganga is, I know, very well known. Alright, this is the pendant here, a little bit more detail. But you see, she's holding a conic on her left hand, and in her right hand, she's holding a lotus. Now, do we classify this one as Lakshmi? Let's see. More closer. Now, let's go back a little bit. Now, about 4th century BC, this is the Panchmark point. The goddess seated on a stool, that's Lakshmi. That's with the elephants. So, we see that there was already the beginnings at that time of how to represent the goddess. This is another very important. The goddess is on a throne. Now, who is she? There's no lotus. You can't see a lotus here. You've seen a few of those points, and you have a lotus. So, she's seated on a throne, but we know that beginnings of, about 4th century BC, we start seeing this representation starting to happen. Then, Kuninga dynasty, somewhere around 2nd century BC, we start seeing goddess appearing holding a lotus in her right hand. And then, also we see some sort of a lotus about the beginning of the Melanesian, Gandharan sculptures, and they're showing a lot. this scenery with lotus petals underneath, but she's holding a cornucopia in her hand. And that cornucopia is very important because it was, remember I said the guru word was actually copied from the Roman coins? You'll see here, there was other things copied from Roman coins. In the first century, we started seeing Roman coins and then Kushan came about, and Kushan copied that Vadasadra showed in the Kamakutya. And then finally, in the whole century, we started seeing Gupta coins where say Sri Vikram, right, and the goddess is seated on the throne, the similar Kushan coins, which is holding a Kamakutya in her hand. So this is not a lotus at this point. This is still a Kamakutya. Right? Krishna Q, Vashishtha. 247, 267. So still, you see God is enthroned with Kanda. But the coin says Adaksha. This is the first coin, the coin issued by the first incumbent Kumar assigned to them. And it says Param Bhagavata. It doesn't say the goddess' name. It says Param Bhagavata. That's his Giruda, because he was a Bhagavata of the God Vishnu. Okay, so here we have him. In the front, you know, holding Rajchandra in his hand, with the Kuruta standing on the front of her, this line. She's seated on the couch, she's got a throne, she's got a Kamakutya. Then we have a next point. We have Varus again sitting on the throne of Kamakutya, but the king is now with his right hand actually putting in the hub. He's putting the operations to the hub. Here, right after Chandra 1, you see a point issued by Samudra. It has the cornucopia and the throne, but instead of
Samudra's Viruda, which is Parakrama, it says Sri Vikrama. So, this is a point that was struck right at the transition from Chandra 1 to Samudra, and they were still using the Chandra 1's title. Which should have been, which is Sri Vikrama, but this coin, because it says under here, it says in Brahmi, Sra Mudra, and it should say Parakrama, which was his title. So here, again, we see Samudra, and then Parakrama, which is what all of his later coins always used. Again, we have a throne in Konikul. Now here, this is a coin called a battle axe coin. The king is actually holding a battle axe right here. Now this is a coin, and the coin prior to that, and the archer type and the javelin types, these are militaristic coins, coins showing that I'm all powerful, I'm the exterminator of all kings. You have to submit to me, I'm coming in your area, either submit to me and come under my jurisdiction or you'll be dead. And these coins basically were struck in the first half of Samudra's reign. Now, she sees this coin, the goddess is still holding a cornucopia, but look below her feet. Now, suddenly, lotus petals are starting to appear. And this is about 344, 360. This is the first half of.
And then, in her hand, you start to see coins, which is possibly a representation of. So we have Raja Lakshmi, Hara Lakshmi being represented here as a progression of the development. And you see here, Battle-Axe Shadow, Lotus, Kanakubia, Kanakubia has disappeared. Now, why is this important? Because these coins are gold and they do not corrode, they do not react. Thousands of years buried in the earth, they still hold everything that was actually struck when it was struck. And you can see the progression. So these are time capsules, and it's very, very important that we are able to use this to supplement our knowledge that we get from excavations and study of archaeology. So Lotus Lord, goddess of the heavens, but she is still seated on a couch. So they have not come artwork design of goddess Lakshmi is centered on the notice. So you still see it in that. Now this bud has become a full-fledged flower in the heavens. And this is slowly and slowly a design that is developing and becoming more and more accepted. So just to recap, Krishna 2, seated on the throne, Chandrabhut 1, seated on the throne, holding a Panditurya. In Samudra, holding a throne, sitting on the throne, Panditurya. Petals are trying to appear. Remember, no petals, but petals are starting to develop, which is very important. And then, that's still a Panditurya. And then we get a flower. And then we start thinking, okay, now the iconography of this goddess is finally developing from our natural connection. So 378 to 381 was a massive turmoil in India, because Samudragupta died. He had two sons, Ramagupta and Chandragupta. Ramagupta was the older one. Now, all Gupta kings, one thing they did very important, they all posted their high heir apparent, the eldest son, as governor of Odisha.
Why? Because Odisha was the center of all the trade routes, north and south, east and west. And if they controlled the trade routes, and it was under their control, they controlled the trade. If they controlled the trade, they controlled the region. So Ramagupta was posted as the governor of Vidisha, and that is where he issued real small copper coins that are still found there today by the hundreds, and they're called, they on the coins they have a Garuda standard, and they say Ramagupta, and there are different, you know, other Garuda on it, lion on it, things like that. So there was a battle for control, because Ramagupta was the heir apparent, but Chandragupta too had more ambition. So Chandragupta, the younger son, basically tries to get control of the empire, but Ramagupta is now the heir apparent, so he's issuing his coins from, he's graduated from issuing coins in copper to gold, but he's holding Chakrapura, not a Garuda standard, because he is the heir apparent. He is the one anointed by the god and the his father possibly to be the heir apparent and take over the Gupta throne. But he does not control the royal mint yet. The royal mint is still not in his control. And he is issuing coins from Ujjain mint, which is a different design of coin. And we'll see that in a minute. So, in 381 AD, Ramagupta's forces
come up to the northern eastern UP area, take over the royal mint, and start issuing coins under this name, but now they have a Garuda standard on it. And that is how we know he's fully in control. This is a coin issued by Chakrapura, and then they have come up there. And then, once he takes control, he has a coin instead of the Chakrapura, so he's holding the but this coin, if you look on the reverse, the goddess is standing not in petals, and she's holding a flower. We don't know, it's not a lotus flower, it's like a daisy flower. She's holding a flower. This is definitely not a lotus flower anymore. Right? But this is a very typical style of the king's head, the goddess's head, the coins missing from the Nisha. But when he takes over the royal throne, this Chakrapura is not important as much as the Garuda, this Suja. And this Garuda and the style of the body that the Chakrapura is very reminiscent of the royal mint coins. Now let's look at the most important part. Goddess has changed from that goddess to this goddess. This is a lotus flower she's holding. So now, with the royal authority and the divine. democracy, blah, blah, blah. It's a long story, but it's all propaganda. You know, now, the important thing about this is coming to in this older brotherhood campaign, you realize what this means. It means if you read every history book, you say the concept of patricide was only in Mughal dynasties and Muslim dynasties and Islamic dynasties. That is totally wrong. Hindu dynasties always had patricide. Older brothers were really cared about younger brothers and they came to power. It was a question of power. And it is proven here in this story of Ramakrishna, you know, being given by several books. Same thing happened with Rotakas. Later on, you'll see, try to take the power, Skanda kills him. And actually, the temple inscription writes down that, you know, I killed my uncle because he was trying to take power when Skanda was trying to take the throne of Kumar. So Chandragupta comes to power, and you see that Goddess Lakshmi is now starting to get complete, but she's no longer holding the crowns here. This is a beautiful style of Chandragupta crowns, and she's now shown seated on the lotus. And this is very important because this is a marker in time. And this marker in time shows us that the transformation that was in the works for a period of 60, 70 years actually became complete. Now, why entrepreneur? This was the point, most commonly struck point by the Guptas and Gupta dynasty. And the Gupta team struck these by the hundreds and thousands. I mean, this was the most common point. Actually, I would guess the majority of the Mughal points you see today in the market, those were probably at one time Gupta gold points that were melted down to, you know, make future gold points in the following years. So here we see a typical royal ring point. It has Lakshmi seated, Lakshmi holding rose flower, seated on the flower, and you see the transformation getting finally complete. So here we have now a Lakshmi seated on the lotus from a Lakshmi or a goddess seated on the flower. Right? Here, now you go back to this point. Why this point? This point shows the goddess seated on the throne. So this is a page from the six million coins in my book. And you can see this is coin number 4. I assigned it to Chandragupta 1. Right here, very rare coin. Right here. So this is on this show, goddess seated on the throne. Right. So this is another point from the Indian view of Kolkata. Right. And goddess is in the throne. This is the coin in the option today. Now look at this reverse. This is actually a reverse from Samudra Gupta's back last time. Coin struck at the very beginning of his manifesto phase. With his outlet, and remember, he was quite an old king, but he was in the military phase and he was young. So this is a place in the early years of Samudra, right after he took over the power from Chandragupta. This is not struck in the later part of Samudra today's, because it was struck in the later part, and we could say the outside point is Chandragupta, because it was struck after this point. You see, here, this is developed, this is later. So this is how I have ascribed that specific coin, this specific coin that is today in Washington, which makes it even more rare, more important. This is definitely an excellent coin and truly a marker of time for our history. So here we have the coin of some. Anybody have any doubts about the Samudra? Well, you shouldn't, because he put his name there. Say Samudra Gupta said. He put his name there. And you know, this is a religious coin. He's conquered the lands, he's expanded his kingdom, he says my name, he's playing musical instrument. As you see him on a and he's holding it on in the hand. And look what happens. This is a concept of channel of view. This is a Boston guy, right? Smart looking guy who has a mustache. So we know this is actually the true core, not something the core. And it says a deep connection now. So some of the look, how you go here? Notice how it's in the two. Wow, the two's outside. So the outside is here, but trying to go to this point, not the one that was in the option. This one, you see it, just like that, will be a low spot. So here, this is the third outside. Very important. So, channel one, and then channel two. And lastly, way back to 4,000, 3,000 BC, we see Mars and all, the star. These are beautiful sculptures and thank God they survived for. They don't get bombed soon, but they survived. So, why are we looking at this? You see, the goddess Durga in Indian culture, or Indian religion, in Indian iconography, only a god of the age. There was nothing called the goddess Durga's name on the lion. Goddess Durga concept was there. Don't get me wrong, the concept in the Puranas was there. The iconography, how you show it to the people, that developed after the Kushans in the book. So think of it as a storytelling, total storytelling. This is a Kushan, second century. Goddess Nana, second one. So, Goddess Nana seated on a lion. Starts off, Chandra Book 1, this period, we have the Indian queen type, a goddess seated on a throne. So, seated on a throne, with lion in her feet, we can sit in a lion, and she is holding a body of her hand. This transforms into Sanjeev Kumar. See, goes from there. Nana transforms into the symbol of Hari Lakshmi around the politics between them. And that is what today we see as the representation of these goddesses. So, the custom standard, showing points, in yesterday's Mahashiv Rathi, this is important. And the reason I put this slide in here is because we read this from books that are more powerful. Says how the Buddhas were rationalists. You know, back then, nobody was a rational about this. They were all praying to all the gods. Rational, Buddha thinks they built Shiva temples. This is a Shiva icon right here. They built Jain statues. They built Buddhist monasteries. They were praying to all gods. Yes, they were rational. Long-lasting religious changes that took place in the revival of the Vedic beliefs and beliefs and rituals. Buddhist and Jain forms of worship. Design evolution is never in a straight line. Even if a new design evolves, the old and familiar designs continue to use, especially when dealing with a medium of trust, which is the hands. So if a population is used to the same design, things will continue.